Now, what role do political dynasties play in the corruption in the Philippines? Joining us for his thoughts on the latest partial tally and its implications is Dr. Daniel Bruno Davis, who studied Philippine politics and corruption at the University of Virginia. Doctor, good afternoon there in Virginia and good morning here in Manila. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
We had been speaking with a local political analyst saying that this is the first time that we don't have just one political party influencing votes for a candidate, but we have several. You know, a candidate can be also part of another party, but there is one thing that has remained constant in getting candidates elected, and that's name recall. It's all about personality and political dynasties, and you believe the same.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, parties really are incredibly transitory. They're just not doing much work to tell voters about politicians, because that's really what parties do, is they provide information on what ideas candidates stand for. But in the Philippines, when parties are swapping in and out all the time, and candidates, you know, run under different party labels, it just doesn't do the same job. So voters turn to what they know. They turn to family name, to the family reputation, in a way that is fairly unusual for a democracy. And it has negative effects, because you end up with elections that are about personality or about connections rather than about ideas. So dynasties really have been a political negative, I think, for a long time in the Philippines.
That's right. We hardly talk about principles here or even their plans, platforms and agenda for the coming administration. It's really all about promises. Time and again, there have been efforts to ban political dynasties, but they've failed because the very people who benefit from it are tasked with abolishing it. But what's interesting about your paper is that political dynasties are linked with corruption. Can you tell us more about this link? Are there advantages, perhaps, or disadvantages?
Yeah, political dynasties make it harder to stop corruption, because they effectively act as a way to protect their members. I mean, that's sort of the overriding goal of a political dynasty, is to keep getting its members elected. But that includes the bad apples as well. It doesn't inherently follow that everyone who has family members also in office must be bad. But when you get bad apples, when you get corrupt politicians, they stay in power because their other members, their dynasties, and these sort of allied dynasties, keep them from being prosecuted. This is especially true because of relatively weak institutions. The ombudsman, which prosecutes corruption, just is relatively toothless in its ability to prosecute. So dynasties are able to effectively box it out and keep it from prosecuting corruption, which sort of makes the problem worse and worse. And as you noted, while the Constitution says that there should be some anti-dynasty legislation, it's never been operationalized, because the dynasties are the ones getting elected. They're the ones in power, so they don't want to effectively ban themselves. It's hard to imagine that happening under the current system, effectively pushing themselves out of power.
And it seems they're also the ones who have the resources to actually mount an election campaign, especially of a nationwide coverage. And now we have the son of the late dictator ascending to the presidency decades later. We have the daughter of a sitting president likely to become vice president. And at the Senate, we have a mother and a daughter serving together, a father, a daughter, brother and sister, brothers among others. What does this mean for politics in any country?
It's not just, these are some of the big national families, but there are very few, Marcoses or, Dutertes out there. What there are is a lot of smaller families that dominate on a local or a provincial level. Before current President Duterte was elected, his family had been holding, the mayorship of Davao City. And, his father was governor in the old province of Davao before it got divided up. So, you know, they were in many ways a very typical sort of local dynasty. And those are what really sort of spread out and dominate. If there was one or two families, it wouldn't really be that big a problem overall. It's the sort of enormous number of them in every corner of the Philippines, where every place has, you know, several political families. And this really stretches back to even before the founding of the Republic. I mean, you can see the roots of this in the American colonial period and in some poor decisions that America made in sort of the early colonial period.
Doctor, some say President Duterte needed his daughter in the presidency or vice presidency as a protection for him against prosecution, as you had already mentioned earlier. And as he faces human rights cases, both abroad and here, is this type of positioning or use of political dynasty something you've seen in other countries, not just here in the Philippines?
Absolutely. This can be a problem in a lot of places. The Philippines has a particularly bad case of it, but you see problems like this exist in a number of countries. You know, just coming to mind, Pakistan has problems with this. In more developed countries, Japan has fairly substantial problems with political dynasties. There's research that shows that they help lower quality candidates get elected, that they make it harder to prosecute corruption. There's a number of negative effects of this. You know, if your name is getting you elected, you don't have to be as talented as someone who doesn't have that name. So you get sort of a diminution of the quality of candidates. But this isn't just in the Philippines by any means. You see this problem in a number of countries. It's just especially bad in the Philippines. And again, it's been bad for a very long time. I think that's one of the key problems, is that this really comes out of the history of the Philippines. You know, the Dutertes trace themselves back to, you know, Spanish era, you know, not royalty exactly, but sort of very powerful, you know, rich people from that era. They've sort of always been a powerful family. So that just continues on, and they're able to use their position to keep the family rolling.
Mm-hmm. So are you saying that the more political dynasties you have in a country, the more corruption you should be able to see in that country?
I think probably that's true, that you see a connection between those things, because the dynasties make it harder to stop corruption. Every country has some problems with corruption. It's a lot in the ability to root it out. And dynasties just make that much harder.
Your research also shows that given the chance, Filipinos would not vote for corrupt politicians. And yet, we have senators and other officials coming back after having been convicted of crimes. Could this be a chance at redemption for them, perhaps, or more opportunity to overextend themselves?
You know, it's hard to imagine them, you know, suddenly cleaning up their act. Yes, I mean, my research does show that all things being equal, you know, Filipino voters don't prefer corrupt politicians, even in, you know, a system with so many issues of vote buying and whatnot. People really don't like corruption. But one of the big unanswered or one of the big difficult questions about corruption is, why do voters say they hate corruption and then elect corrupt politicians? And part of it is, you know, that they know these politicians, and that when the family gets well known, it can sort of override that interest. So if voters are somewhat more likely to reject a corrupt politician, but they're a lot more likely to support a politician whose family they know, those two things can essentially clash. Mm-hmm.
And so what will it take, Professor, to end this cycle of political dynasties? If you can't change it at the legislative level, how else do you change it? Change the narrative.
People getting really sick of it, basically. I don't think it changes without sort of broad social movement. This is a really entrenched problem. Smaller problems can be dealt with in other ways, but when you have a problem that's so widespread and so long running, you really need sort of a broad push to sort of fundamentally reform things. I don't see it happening without a really sort of broad-based social movement behind it.
All right. Dr. Daniel Bruno Davis of the University of Virginia, grateful you could share your thoughts with us. Thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.